Good afternoon. First of all, let me thank India Foundation for inviting me here. It's a pleasure. It's a delight to be given the opportunity to speak to all of you. I think what we need to begin with before we talk about what might be the policies that we would like to see going forward is a little bit of where we are and where we've come from and what we need to change for having inclusive growth. I mean, inclusive growth or a growth that has economic prosperity and delivers it to all citizens, all the people of the country who should have the ability to earn their livelihood. And I'm not saying jobs, I'm saying earn their livelihood, who should have the opportunity to have a good quality of life, is something that is of utmost importance looking forward. I just want to take us back to this morning and when people, and even yesterday evening, when people talk about India and India through the centuries, then we were talking about a country, an economy, where there was trade, commerce, business, crafts that were growing and flourishing through for many, many centuries. It is well known how India was trading with many of her neighbors as well, through various land routes, through various maritime routes. What is interesting is that that was a time when there were least restrictions. So for example, I work on the rupee and macroeconomics, so my examples would be more related to those. So for example, the rupee was used not just in India, but it was used for trade in many other countries as well. In fact, going all the way to the 1950s, the rupee was accepted as legal tender in the Middle East, in Kuwait, in many other countries other than India. The reason I point this out and the reason I want us to remember that there is a history to what we want to do today is to bring to your notice the fact that all the changes, the restrictions that were put on the economy, the socialist orientation of the economy really began in the 1960s. In fact, in the mid-60s. And it is from then onwards that we said how much can you produce, who can you sell to, at what price can you produce, you need a license for new industry, you need a license to import, you cannot use the rupee without the permission of the Reserve Bank, nobody abroad can hold the rupee, and various other controls both on production, on imports, on exports, the whole license raj that we talked about. And it was that legacy that continues, a part of that legacy that continues even today. It is, of course, as all of us know, in 1991, that because growths under the regime of the 60s and the 70s and the 80s that we had put in place and almost restricted economic activity, restricted commerce, restricted trade, limited the use of our currency so much that what we got was very, very slow growth leading to a crisis. And in 91, when we did a reform, then we did a partial reform. Just to go back to what does the word reform mean? Reform fundamentally refers to countries like ours, emerging economies, that had put government restrictions in place. And it fundamentally refers to undoing many of those restrictions and undoing away with excessive state intervention in the economy. So the agenda for reforms that was undertaken in 91 did, of course, do away with import licensing, did away with industrial licensing and a lot of other restrictions that on exports and on trade that had been put. But what it did not do and left undone and is still halfway done and is in the process of doing, which is what I feel are the critical things to be done for inclusive growth and prosperity today, are things such as financial sector reform, reform in agriculture. Now, if we look at what happened in agriculture and in banking and other parts of the financial sector, including bond market, derivatives, including currencies, is that the system that prevailed from the 60s to the 90s, so, you know, 50 years, we've had 50 years of public sector banks, now we've had excess capital controls in many, many parts of the economy. That system was not changed, partly because of the entrenched bureaucratic interests, partly because of the fear of the political class, and partly because of vested interests that sought to use many of the resources. I mean, many of you would be aware of how often bureaucrats go and use public sector bank facilities, whether at home or in abroad, whether it is guest houses, whether it is cars, whether, you know, many, many other things. So it is vested interests which, you know, from the 90s till we see the political class, we see the bureaucracy, as well as those who, the various regulators who are in, who have entrenched interests in those that have not allowed reform to happen. I would emphasize financial sector reforms, which is a field that I've been working on as in my job as professor at the National Institute of Public Finance and Policy, where we have understood that when an economy is doubling its GDP every 10 years, which an economy like India growing at 7.5% growth rate is doing so, financial sector has to keep pace with it. And unless we reform the financial sector, which is the brain of the economy, people who, the young of the economy, the demographic dividend we often talk about, who may have, you know, worked very hard to acquire the education, acquire the skills, need to be able to get access to capital, need to be able to get access to finance, to be able to put their dreams, to be able to put them in place, to be able to get the opportunities that they want, to convert those opportunities into means of earning their livelihood, whether it is in rural India, whether it is in small towns, in the agricultural sector, all over the country. Finance and the old style of finance that we've had is giving money to a few, is giving money to, you know, the government, to some priority sector lending institutions. It is giving money to things like, you know, now they're in big trouble, but various companies, either directly or through non-bank financial intermediaries. But the extent to which small businesses get loans is clearly still inadequate. The very fact that after 50 years of bank nationalization, we had to start a scheme called Mudra, which asked banks to target loans to small businesses, meant that the very objective of bank nationalization, which was to give finance to bulk of the population and access to to rural India and to small loans, had failed. Had it succeeded, had there been adequate levels of competition, adequate levels of independence or functioning of that system, what you would not have had to, after 50 years, direct banks to undertake such an exercise. To go back to what I believe is necessary for economic growth that is inclusive, economic growth that brings prosperity to everybody, is that the government prioritize and goes back to doing the basic function of government. So expenditure, for example, should be prioritized to public goods, law and order, justice system, roads, clean air, clean water. No, public goods where the market fails to deliver, rather than those things, rather than running airlines or industries or various businesses or banks. If there is this prioritization, it is far more equal for the poor, for the rich, for everybody who lives in the country and wants access. The inclusion should focus on access to opportunity. So people who live in remote areas are better off if they have access to roads. And I think, you know, everyone in this country understands that only the state can do law and order and justice. And the state has to deliver. And the state has to deliver on those things. So even in terms of reform, I would say that the priority that we have to put in place is to do minimize interference in the state in markets, regulate markets. When markets fail, then it is the job of the state to regulate markets. It is the job of the government to make markets function. But fundamentally, we have been for hundreds of years a market-based economy, and despite the 50 years in which most of us were born and brought up, and therefore which changed the way we think about how much the state should do and more, do more and more and more, we need to get out of that. And that, for me, is what will give us inclusive economic prosperity. Thank you.